Our reading this morning is from Edwin Markham. He drew a circle that shut me out. Heretic, rebel, a thing to flout. But love and I had wit to win. We drew a circle and took him in. This is the third in a three-part series of sermons on Earl Morse Wilbur's Unitarian trinity of values, freedom and reason and tolerance. On the first Sunday, we explored and celebrated five freedoms that shaped us: the freedom to gather in covenant, the freedom to believe as reason and conscience require, the freedom of the pulpit and its companion freedom, the freedom of the pew, and finally, what a friend of mine calls the freedom of the plate, the freedom to support the congregation of our choosing rather than be taxed to support a state church. The second Sunday, last Sunday, our focus was on reason and on the four heresies, or on four of the heresies, that resulted when our forebears applied their reason to matters of religion. Those heresies were the unity of God, universal salvation, the understanding that revelation is not sealed, the idea that God might not be necessary for a happy and moral life. This morning, we're going to look at the third of those three values, tolerance. Now, I have been challenged by the word tolerance as one of our cardinal values since the very first time that I read it. In A Chosen Faith, Forest Church defines tolerance in a way that echoes my understanding of the word. He says that tolerance is often understood as a willing to bear with repugnance ideas and beliefs which are alien to one's own. Now, historically, Unitarians were to extend to others the right to act from reason and conscience, even when the other's reason and conscience caused them to hold ideas that Unitarians might find repugnant. And specifically, in its origin, we're talking about tolerance of different religious beliefs. And initially, tolerance of different religious beliefs within the larger Christian tradition. Now, 500 years ago, when religious tolerance first became a defining characteristic of Unitarianism, before and during the Protestant Reformation, it wasn't a value that anyone could take for granted. Their commitment to religious tolerance set the emerging Unitarians apart from Calvinists and Catholics both of whom were known to burn at the stake anyone whose theological frames of reference were not congenial to their own perspectives. If you want to explore this era in a little more depth, you might Google King John Sigismund of Transylvania, the only Unitarian monarch in history, and the one who authored the Edict of Torda, the first document of religious toleration. Or you might look at Michael Servetus from Spain, who was a Trinitarian Universalist back before we had Universalists, and who was ultimately burned at the stake for his heresies. Now, this isn't to say that as soon as this notion of tolerance was framed, our forebears were good at sticking to it. Our Puritan ancestors struggled with the whole idea, and their track record on tolerance is not good. The churches of the Standing Order in New England, some of which became Unitarian congregations, branded Quakers and burned witches. But eventually this notion of a commitment to religious tolerance resurfaced. It resurfaced in the Transcendentalists with the affirmation that revelation was not sealed, and it resurfaced again in the Parliament of World Religions in the 1890s. Unitarians participated in that event, which brought together for the very first time representatives of assorted Christian traditions, along with representatives from 12 other non-Christian world religions. So, Jains and Sikhs and Muslims and Buddhists
and Hindus, along with lots and lots of assorted flavors of Christianity. Now, to this day, religious tolerance is an important value within our Unitarian Universalist congregations, as UU Christians and UU humanists and UU atheists and others often worship together and serve together on the same committees and march together in the same marches. So if we think about tolerance as a widening circle, then the smallest circle for us is that circle of religious tolerance. That's the starting place. Now, the next circle of tolerance that I want to suggest as the circle ripples outward arises from that notion we talked about last week, that we are all saved by God's mercy, and from Channing's notion that we're all created in likeness to God. This circle, then, is what I think of as social tolerance. It's the recognition that people of other social states and classes are equal to us in their essence, equal to us in the eyes of God, and so must be accorded the same freedoms that we treasure for ourselves. The ideas that we're all saved and that we're all created in likeness to God were at the heart of the social gospel in the 19th century, and they motivated Unitarians and Universalists alike to work for causes as varied as the abolition of slavery, women's suffrage, rights for the mentally ill, and public education, in every case, including a previously excluded group in the circle of the community. In more recent years, that same set of values, maybe articulated a little bit differently, have motivated us to expanding our circle of those who count as fully human. And so, Unitarian Universalists were among the first to ordain women, to side with African Americans in their struggle for civil rights, to shift our hymnals and writings to the use of inclusive language, to welcome and ordain gay, lesbian, bisexual, and transgender people in our congregations and in our pulpits, and to advocate for the right to marry. But even with all these expansions of the circle, there are still people who are not here. There are still people who are not included. People who are differently abled sometimes struggle to find their way into our buildings. And class and cultural biases still limit our engagement with some of our brothers and sisters. So tolerance has been hugely important for us. And yet, I remain uneasy with the idea that tolerance alone is sufficient. First, because my intuition suggests to me that we ought to be working towards honoring the inherent worth and dignity of every person rather than simply tolerating each other. And second, because there are clearly behaviors which should not be tolerated. And a lack of clarity around the meaning of tolerance in our faith tradition might in fact lead us to tolerate things which violate those other commitments to freedom and to reason. Now, I'd like to think we do more than just tolerate women and people of color and sexual minorities in our midst. And I'd like to think that we do more than bear our differences in spite of whatever distaste we might feel toward one another's theologies or life choices. I'd like to think that we have some common values and that those common values let us move past tolerance toward an authentic respect for the authentic and inherent worth and dignity of each person here. And you know, where we share values, that's probably true. Respect easily replaces tolerance as the higher virtue. But what about those places where our values don't overlap? What about the places where our values are in conflict, the places where one person's religious convictions lead them to restrict the freedoms or deny the full humanity of another? I suppose I could talk here about the role of tolerance in serious issues, like whether it violates a woman's full humanity to insist that she be veiled in public, or whether it violates a gay couple's civil rights to deny them the protections and privileges granted to their heterosexual peers with legal marriage. These are huge issues of human and civil rights, and they're grounded in religious values. And the challenge here is it would be so easy to get caught in those issues and to tiptoe around the religious differences implicit there rather than staying focused on tolerance and respect. Emerson once wrote that preaching is life passed through the fire of thought. And so for the next few minutes, as I grapple with ideas of tolerance and respect, I'm going to do it with a smaller issue, but an issue from my own life. I'm going to talk about chickens. Yep. You see, I went to the chicken forum in El Dorado, where I live, yesterday. And if you look at the little picture that's in the paper this morning behind the sign up in the upper left corner, you will see Zoe and Isaac and me kind of blurry in the background. Within the space of an hour, it became very clear to me that tolerance can be a challenge when you have competing values, competing worldviews, or even just competing interpretations of the same values and worldview. Now, the debate in my neighborhood is over whether or not residents should be permitted to keep hens and maybe goats, but it was mostly about hens. And if so, in what numbers and under what conditions? Currently, hens are allowed if they are pets, but not allowed if they are livestock. The initial series of concerns that was raised suggested all hens should be considered livestock since they're raised for eggs. The anti-hen arguments continued with assertions that hens are potentially noisy and smelly and might attract predators and contaminate the water table and lower property values. Now, to answer these concerns, the El Dorado Board had brought in some expert presenters who responded that in small numbers, hens are actually very quiet, quieter than dogs, as long as you don't have any roosters. Well-managed hens are not smelly. Predators are already endemic in El Dorado and will make short work of any flock that's improperly secured. The hydrologist who spoke reassured people that given our soil types, the amount of rain we get, and the depth of our water table, there's very little risk of water table contamination from a household flock. And in fact, since a hen requires only about 10 ounces of water per day, they're not going to stress our water supply. So property values remained the underlying concern. And there was no data offered on whether allowing small numbers of chickens compromises property values. So on the face of it, this should be a very easily resolved issue. It should be possible to secure data on home values and sales in other parts of the country that do or do not permit chickens, or in neighborhoods before and after chickens were allowed. If it could be shown that chickens did not impinge upon the neighbor's property values, then it should be a fairly minor matter to arrive at covenants that minimize the nuisance factor. But you know, the intensity of the argument suggested that there was something else at work. That in fact, it was a matter of competing visions and competing values. As far as I am able to discern, the issue isn't actually chickens. It's social class. What kind of people are allowed to live in El Dorado? As I listened to the presenters, I heard an unspoken assumption that Martha Stewart, sustainability and ethical eating to the contrary, keeping chickens is not a middle-class endeavor proper to a middle-class community, but is somehow an activity which is more typical of working class or rural poor lifestyles, and that by allowing that activity, El Dorado risks being confused with those neighborhoods and reduces its desirability as a place to live. Now, for all I know, that might be true. But it doesn't make either classism or its frequent companion, racism, right. Nor does fear provide the community with a reasonable grounds for decision making. So, even in this relatively minor debate, I am challenged by the notions of tolerance and respect. And here is the challenge that I think claiming tolerance as a primary virtue, rather than respect, places me in as a person of faith, and perhaps places you in as well. If my primary value is tolerance, then I am guided to accept my neighbor's point of view and to allow his or her biases, be they anti-chicken or anti-Catholic or anti-immigrant, I'm guided to accept their biases, even if that is to my disadvantage, even if it undermines my freedoms or someone else's and goes against the dictates of reason. If tolerance is my primary virtue, then I am called to tolerate my neighbor's fears about chickens or the working class, even if their arguments are ungrounded. Whereas, if my primary virtue is respect for the inherent worth and dignity of each person, myself and my neighbor, then I can act in ways that affirm and promote my neighbor's worth and dignity at the same time that I take exception to my neighbor's beliefs and actions. As long as my tone and my behaviors are respectful in their style, in their intent, and in their content, I may argue my case against your point of view to the very best of my ability. And the converse is also true. If my neighbor can respectfully and successfully show me that chickens do in fact lower property values, then I will need to accede to my neighbor's argument. I will need to tolerate their respectfully presented and carefully supported point of view, even if I don't like the outcome. Our tradition teaches that tolerance or respect is to be for the diversity of personhood and the diversity of belief. But just as the freedoms we talked about 2 weeks ago are limited by our willingness to accept covenant, and our reasoning is limited by the fact that we reason together in community, our tolerance should be limited as well by our commitments to freedom and to reason. There are values and behaviors that should not be tolerated, although the holders of those values need to be treated with respect. Even an expanding circle must have some defining limits if it's to remain a circle. So, as a Unitarian Universalist faith community, our challenge then becomes to consciously choose our boundaries, to identify the behaviors that can and should be tolerated in the community, and to teach and support our limits with respect and care and affection. When we're paying attention, we don't define the boundaries of our community by belief or by race or by gender, but rather by voluntary behaviors that those who seek to join us in community can choose to embrace. We seek to establish boundaries that affirm and promote shared values. Since behavior is chosen, a covenant grounded in values-based behavior will welcome people, regardless of race, ethnicity, education, gender, and social class. So freedom, reason, and respect are three watchwords of our faith tradition, which have stood us in good stead and gotten us into lots of trouble and brought us to where we are today. But that's not all. Freedom and reason and respect really represent the Unitarian half of our faith tradition. The other half, the Universalist side, brings as its highest value a crucial balancing factor: love. In our struggle for freedom, in our application of reason, and as we draw an ever wider circle of tolerance and respect, we need to remember the words of Michael Servetus, who 450 years ago said, "We need not think alike to love alike." Freedom, reason, and respect serve us best when they are guided by love. And that's another sermon. Blessed be.